Hello and welcome. We have with us today Professor Salim Surani, who is a pulmonary care and sleep physician. He's an adjunct professor at Texas A&M, and then he's a practitioner in Corpus Christi. So welcome, Dr. Surani.
Likewise. Welcome to you.
Yeah, absolutely. Those who are on social media, these are Dr. Surani's social media handles at SURSAR on Twitter, Facebook SR Surani, and he's the founding director and chairman of itsyourlifefoundation.org. So please do check it out. Dr. Surani, thank you so much for being here with us today. You have been very informative about COVID-19 symptoms and treatment. We have recorded some of these videos in last week. Today, this is very interesting. We come across one of your publications in emergency medicine. You're talking about this is called TVMD study, which is very interesting. My understanding is it's a publication you have based on all TV serials in America, which has gone through with each episode of cardiopulmonary resuscitation and arrest. So, which is very interesting. It caught our eyes, and we're wondering if you can tell a little bit more about that publication and what the results came out from that publication.
I don't think so. That can be any better time than talking about the TV dramas and TV serials where everyone is in lockdown and everyone is watching the TV and they're glued to the thing and they're watching their favorite shows. And you can imagine that any show which is medical, it's going down towards the area where there is a heart attack or cardiac arrest. And that is where the whole drama starts. This all, you know, caught our interest was in 1996 by DMs. They recorded that, you know, in the drama, he looked into all the television dramas in the past. And what they found was that 77 to 100% of the people who are going to the arrest, they actually were surviving. And we know as a practicing physician, wow, that number is very high. And, you know, the folks who are watching, they really feel that, you know, whenever there is a TV serial, there is a lot of dramatization going on. And sometimes the things are going very fast, like you have a trauma code or you have a patient who comes with acute MI or acute stroke, and we all understand that that is happening. So what we decided to do is create a fun project for some of the students and residents. And what can be better? You know, at that time it would be ideal if we had a lockdown and the people are watching the TV. So we didn't have the lockdown, and we selected 31 television MD serial where there are physicians and nurses and hospitals going on from 2010 to 2018. And we made them watch 836 episodes. That's a lot of episodes to watch. That's a lot of TV time. Boy, I think, I don't know how they will be passing their medical college exam, but it was done over a period of time. And we had actually two providers who were given a 43 questionnaires, and they were recording the race, sex, age, demographics, and their thing was to go and look into first all the 836 serials and find out how many CPR events happen. And what they were able to locate out of 836 serials or episodes, 216 had a CPR. Out of those, we had some missing information or some missing data. 194 serials were selected, and we based our data on that. So now we'd like to know what are the nice serials we are watching. And you know, it was amazing. I don't know how good those were, because when we picked out everything possible, we took the serials which has the which were in English, or they had the English subtitle, not dubbed in English. So there may be a Chinese or some other language MD drama which may have seen it, but we did not include it in the study. So I'll give you some of the, one is Emergency was a serial, Emily MD was a serial, Grey's Anatomy. Grey's Anatomy was, I think, one of the top ones, because we had about 2011 to 2018, 181 episodes, and there were 34 resuscitation attempts were there and in that. But on the other hand, we had a Boston EMS in 2016, 11 episodes. We had Critical, Doc Martin, Doc Foster, Emily MD, Heartbeat, Morocco 11 Times, War, Night Shifts, Royal Plains, Red Band Society, Save My Life, Saving Hope, Good Doctor, The Resident. So there was a lot of the stuff we looked through that. And thank God I didn't have to watch all those serials. So what they were doing is they go through those 43 questionnaire, and what we wanted to look at it is the CPR is being carried out in the TV drama good, bad, or they had some errors. That was the thing. What was their compression depth? Whether they were going for 5 centimeter? What was the rate? Were they going with 100 to 120 heart rate there? What was their survival out of the hospital? It means, you know, from survival or to out of the hospital, walking out of the hospital, what was their survival? We were also looking at it, how many episodes of BFib were there? How many asystole were there? Who was surviving more, the male or the female? So very, very interesting things we were looking at it. And one of the thing is, it's very interesting that we realized that only 32% of the people were having a correct depth of compression. 44% of the folks were getting an adequate compression rate. So even though we had a very nice drama going on and scenario going on, but they were not the real life. And thank God, you know, if it would be real life, if you do that poor compression job and poor rate job, I don't think so we will have good survival rate. Survival to going out of the hospital discharge, that's another interesting thing we noticed. Almost 67% of the male were getting survived, whereas only 44% of the, 32% of the female were surviving. And I don't know what inclination of the dramas were there. There were more male survivors than the female survivors. That was very interesting. The other thing we noticed that when we look into the thing that who was initiating CPR, it was almost 83% of the time it was initiated by the physician, sometime by the nurses. But what we also look into is that who was doing the compression better, whether it was a doctor, it was a nurse, or it was a paramedic. And if I have to make a guess, most of the people will think it's a doctor. Answer is absolutely not. What we found was that the physician compression accurately CPR was only 42% of the time. The nurses was 44, and paramedics was doing the best 64.
So the physicians in those TV serials were the worst among all three.
That is true. And I hope that's not true in the real life. Yeah. But that was what we found in the drama serial. Again, a lot of the patients were going into the ventricular fibrillation, and at least one-fifth of the patients were just going in into the complete asystole. And again, we saw that the defibrillation was performed in 46% of the cases. That again tells us that it doesn't match. If you are having a 66% of the patient having a VFib, you got to have a 66% of the patient having a defibrillation. And the drug administered were much lesser. So I think they focus more on the drama and chest compression, and sometimes, you know, even doing an open thoracotomy if there is a trauma patient come in, which is fine. And drug administered were not that much. Again, the voltage of the compression was not very accurate. So in other words, if you have a VFib, you have to shock with 200 joules. What we found was that two-thirds of them were getting a correct joule there. So again, given a thing, that doesn't matter whether they do a good job in compression, good job in the rate, they did have a better survival. And that all depends on what the real life is. And that is one of the things we wanted to bring it out, that everyone is watching there. And this is a very critical time where a lot of the folks are getting admitted in the ICU. A lot of the patients are going into the arrest. And the family is watching the dramas. And they feel like, you know, what is wrong? You know, everyone is getting, doing good. So I think that was a very interesting comparison. We wanted to bring it out that, okay, this is a real life and this is what happened. And what we did was also, we tried to have not one person collect the data. So what we had at a two provider actually go through the 836 serial, identify 216 CPR. And what they did was they both went through those questionnaire. And then we looked into it that if there was any discrepancy, we actually had a third person look at it, and then they come up with that thing. And if we cannot resolve the differences, then each three have to go together and make sure that they all agree on it.
So that was a pretty robust methodology, making sure there's no investigator bias by one person, then you had more than one person looking into it.
And we did not watch the dramas.
Yeah, that is pretty phenomenal in that sense, that having this methodology. And I think it gives a message, and it's more in a public service, public health perspective, that because, you know, even before lockdown time, many of us were watching or have watched these serials, but during lockdown time, the chances of us watching some of these serials, especially the layman public watching these serials, kind of it sets up higher expectations for the outcome of a CPR process on the public side that, okay, once you do it, 70-75% will survive. In reality, in real life, the rates of success is way lower than those which has been shown in the TV. So any comment on that, that how...
Yeah, it's 2-11%. Some studies have shown 3-10%. If you're coming out with a PEA, the survival is very poor. And what we are talking about, even if you make it to the arrest, what is the probability you're going to go out of the hospital alive?
And these are some of these are witnessed arrests rather than out of the hospital arrest that you don't know how long they were out of respiration, out of cardiac rhythm, and so on and so forth. So it's the discrepancy of a 70% survival in TV drama and TV CPR versus 10, 15, 20% or less than 20%. That's a huge gap. And I hope some of these research, what you have done and then publication could be translated for general public's consumption, and they understand that the expectations, false expectations get set by these TV or movie portrayal of CPR outcomes could be detrimental, that those could be very heavy on somebody, unfortunately, whose family member has to go through with it, and they might expect the same way as it was shown in TV.
You know, I think you have to balance between the drama and the real life. And I think that is true for everything. You know, I think we have more dramas in the everything. And I think we have to talk the facts, the science, the real. And one of the thing is, you know, from their point of view, I mean, George Clooney was my favorite. I used to watch him and we used to love him. You don't want the George Clooney to go and 90% of his patients are not making through. So sometimes I understand that you have to make the anchors and the hero look good. But at the same time, I think, you know, there has to be some disclaimer that in real life, not that many people are surviving. Because what we are seeing in the dramas, that is what the public see and feel. And when it happens in the real life, they have no clue that, you know, if you are going through a out of hospital cardiac arrest or in hospital cardiac arrest, and if your rhythm is not the VFib or VTAC, your chance of pulling out of it and walking out of the hospital is very, very slim. And I think, you know, we have to balance. And that's what we try to do, is more of an educational role. And we wanted to make sure that what we are saying is based on a very robust information, not like, you know, I always felt that, you know, and, you know, Dr. Gronis was a PI, and that he always felt, and we always felt that, boy, you know, we wish we can be like that. You know, all our patients are surviving. But then we felt that, you know, we want to be like them, but at the same time, the reality is very different and very tough. So we just wanted to make sure that we bring to the public, bring to the healthcare providers that, well, we did a very thorough job in going through that many serials and episodes. And I hope that those the students had a good time and had a fun in watching those dramas.
No, absolutely. I think, thank you. Congratulations to you and Dr. Varon for taking on this project, publishing it. It's recently published, like last month, I believe, less than 2 weeks ago. Very recent publications. For those who have not read it, please go ahead and read it. Put down your comments in our session here. And then put down what other areas you want us to have some of these studies designed and conducted. Not just for fun part, but it's educational part for general public. So then the right expectations could be set. Of course, there are creative limitations from the TV or movie sites or DRP sites and all. But having that disclaimer would be, I think, very justifiable. That's justified that, hey, this doesn't portray the actual life outcomes of CPR or cardiopulmonary resuscitation. So point well said. Thank you so much for doing the study. It's a lot of hard work. And thank you so much. It's very pertinent as people are watching, sitting at home watching TV or something else. I'm sure they'll come across with one or two of these episodes, and then they might, this video might make them think that, oh yeah, that makes sense in that sense. So thank you so much for being with us today,
Dr. Surani. Thank you for having me here.
Yeah. And for those who are on social media, just a quick shout out to Dr. Surani's Twitter and Facebook account, and check out his foundation. It's called It's Your Life Foundation.org. It's It's always a pleasure to have you with us, Dr. Surani, and then we'll bring you back again for COVID-related research, clinical practice, and many more episodes. Thanks for being with us, and for our viewers, please watch, subscribe, like, and subscribe. That's only when we get notified to these videos, which we'll upload on a frequent basis.